We started our journey with LPP, linear programming problem. Let's call that LPP, that beginning LPP, a general LPP, because you had the objective function like this. For example, maximize z equal to 3x1 plus 4x2 plus 7x3 plus 9x4, just for example, and the constraints. Just for example, x1 plus 2x2 plus 3x3 plus 2x4 less than equal to 8, and likewise you had another constraint, and all the variables, if you want to solve this problem by simplex method, then all the variables must be greater than equal to 0. If they are not, we will do some transformation in the variable, substitution in the variable, so that we can present them as, or their substitution as, greater than equal to 0. Then only you can apply simplex method to solve this generalized LPP. Why I am calling this a generalized LPP, general LPP? Because you have the variables with different coefficients in objective function, and particularly in constraint, the coefficients are 1, 2, 3, 4, anything, any coefficient, and because of this we are calling this a general LPP. Okay, so why I am saying this a general LPP, because ahead you are going to see some specialization in this LPP. Now, after seeing simplex method, after seeing general LPP and the solution by simplex method, we then turn to transportation problem. Okay, we have put the transportation problem in this kind of matrix. Here, this thing JBCs, we call them as the plants or the sources, and PQR, whatever written here, as the destinations, and this we call as the cost per unit of transportation. Here is the capacity, here is the requirement, and the formulation of this problem, LPP formulation of this problem, was our objective was to minimize the total cost of transportation. So variable was Xij, where Xij stands for the quantity to be transported from I to J. So our objective function became 3 into x11 plus 7 into x12 plus 4 into x13 plus 8 into x21, so on up till 6 into x33. Okay, and the constraint, where because A has the capacity of 100, so you cannot transport more than 100 units from A to P, Q and R. So therefore our constraint becomes x11 plus x12 plus x13 less than equal to 100, and likewise second constraint, that is for from B, becomes x21 plus x22 plus x23 less than equal to 200, which is the capacity of B, and likewise third, x31 plus x32 plus x33 less than equal to 300. This was one group of constraint, and another group of constraint happened to be x11 plus x21 plus x31 greater than equal to 50, 150, because it was requirement. The sum getting transported to P from A or B or C must be equal to 150 or greater than 8. So likewise, you had second constraint x12 plus x22 plus x32 greater than equal to 150, and third constraint x13 plus x23 plus x33 greater than equal to 250. So this formulation we have seen in length in the transportation model formulation lecture. What is important for us in this discussion is, this is a specially structured linear programming problem. In what way it is specially structured? Because all the coefficients of all the variables in the constraints are either 1 or 0. For example, x11 has coefficient 1 here, and in this constraint, there is 0 coefficient to x11. In this constraint, there is 0 coefficient to x11. In this constraint, there is 1 coefficient, and rest in another constraint, the coefficient of x11 is 0. In any variable in two-dimensional transportation problem will appear in two constraints with coefficient 1. Any variable. For that matter, if you take the case of x22, it is appearing in the second constraint and it is appearing in the fifth constraint. x23, it is appearing in second constraint and it is appearing in sixth constraint. Any variable will appear just twice and that too with coefficient 1. There is no other coefficient. If it exists, if the for any variable for that matter in transportation problems formulation, the coefficient will be either 1 or 0, unlike any coefficient the variable has any coefficient in general LPP. Here in transportation problem, the coefficient of the variable in the constraint is either 1 or 0. So we call this as specially structured LPP. But on the right hand side, you are seeing that the constant is 100, 200, 300, 150, 150, 250. In transportation algorithm, we then have seen how to balance the problem, and in the balance problem, this constraint then turned to equality type constraints. Okay, so that this thing you can see in the transportation simplex method lecture. This problem can be solved by simplex method, but because of the special structure of this linear programming formulation, we redesigned the simplex method, and that simplex method is called as transportation simplex method. That is much simpler in presentation as compared to this simplex which we have seen for general LPP. Now there is further specialization. Now you are having in this problem, this problem looks like this problem except for two things. It doesn't have anything written on the right hand side of the table and on the bottom side of this table. There is nothing written. Okay. Here our concern is, this problem is called as assignment or pairing problem. Okay. So what is so specific about this problem? This problem talks about if I assign A to P, then there is a cost of 3. What is A, B, C and what is P, Q, R? This can be anything. A, B, C could be job and P, Q, R could be machine. A, B, C could be operator and P, Q, R could be job. Okay, anything can be, anything can be that in between which you are seeing, looking for pairing. Now, if A is assigned to P, the cost is 3. If A is assigned to Q, the cost is 7. And if A is assigned to R, the cost is 4. Right? Now, the orientation of the problem is little bit different. Here, it was about transporting the quantity from A to either P or Q or R, or P and Q and R. Here, the question is, to which particular thing here this thing is to be assigned, this thing is to be paired. If A is paired with Q, the cost is 7, this is the cost matrix. If B is assigned to R, the cost is 2. If C is assigned to P, for example, the cost is 3, right? So the problem is simply assigning A with any one of these 3, B with any one of these 3 and C with any one of these 3, so that A is assigned to only one of these 3. B also and C also is assigned to only one of these 3, and P also is assigned to only one of A, B or C. Q is also assigned to only one of A, B or C, and R also. Right? This is an assignment problem. Okay. I can put this problem in the framework of this. Okay, I know that A is to be assigned only to P or Q or R. If it is assigned to P, it cannot be assigned to R, it cannot be assigned to Q. And that's true with B as well as C also. So what I will be doing, I can put here to make this problem similar to this. To make this assignment problem similar to transportation problem, I can simply put here 1, 1, 1 and here also 1, 1, 1. Now this looks like a transportation problem, right? This problem looks like a transportation problem. I can say that A is a plant with capacity 1, B is a plant with capacity 1, and C is a plant with capacity 1, and P, Q, R are the destinations which require 1, 1, and 1, and this is a balanced problem. Now I can solve this assignment problem after this modification by what is called as transportation simplex method. Wherein initial allocation I can do by northwest corner rule or least cost method or Vogel's approximation method. Once done by that, once initial allocation is done, then I can optimize the allocation by using modified distribution method or MODI method or stepping stone method, MODI method being preferred. Right? But even after transforming this problem to a transportation algorithm, to a transportation structure, I still won't prefer to use transportation algorithm. There is a reason for that. That reason for not using transportation simplex method for solving assignment problem. You can solve the assignment problem by transportation simplex method, but the troubles in using transportation simplex method for solving assignment problem, let us look into it, and then you will get convinced that why the transportation simplex method is not a good choice for solving assignment problem. Okay. Just look at this. Now there are 9 cells. 9 variables are there in this problem. Right? In this problem, there are 9 variables. We will be seeing the formulation of this problem as well. Okay? So 9 variables are there in this problem. Now there are m is 3. M number of rows is equal to 3. N is also equal to 3. So the number of allocations should be equal to number of allocations. Here I write number of allocations. Number of allocations is equal to m plus n minus 1, means 3 plus 3 minus 1. That is equal to 5 allocations should be there. If you solve this problem by transportation algorithm, 5 should be there. But if you go by the requirement of assignment, you will be needing just 3 allocations. Okay, you will be getting 3 allocations. Okay, whereas you need 5. Okay. So, for filling up the gap between what is required and what you will be getting, you will have to allocate 2 epsilons, isn't it? Now, suppose say the problem, the dimension of the assignment matrix is a 10 by 10. Meaning that there are 10 jobs and there are 10 machines to perform one job on one machine. So this means that if you are going to do the assignment, there will be only 10 assignments. Okay. And if you want to solve this problem by transportation algorithm, so number of allocations you should get will be equal to 10 plus 10 minus 1, 19 allocations. You need 19 allocations, but if you just go by the philosophy of assignment problem, assignment model, you will be getting 10, right? So you are short of nine allocations if you solve the 10 by 10 assignment problem by transportation algorithm. Nine allocations you will be having short of. So it is a heavy case of degeneracy wherein you need 9 epsilons to be inserted, to be allocated from your side, right? And allocating epsilon is not an easy process, because for allocating epsilon, you every time have to say that it doesn't form the closed loop with the existing allocations. Okay, so this you will have to do 9 times. So allocating epsilon 9 times is not an easy job. So this transportation algorithm is not a good proposal for solving assignment problem. Okay, so it is for this reason the assignment model is called as degenerate case of transportation model. And having convinced about the reason that because of which we do not use transportation simplex method for solving assignment problem, then what is the algorithm for solving assignment problem? For solving assignment problem, we use a very simple algorithm based on Hungarian mathematician, and the technique is called as Hungarian technique for solving assignment problem. It is very simple technique. Before we see assignment, the Hungarian technique for solving assignment problem, we will be just seeing the formulation of assignment problem, right? So here it is. For the same problem, the assignment problem is formulated exactly in the similar style the transportation problem is formulated. Okay, so just look at this. The cost per unit of transportation, cost of assignment is given to you in this matrix, and the variable which you will be taking for writing the formulation will be little different than it was for writing the formulation of transportation problem. Here the question is which particular machine, for example, is to be assigned which particular job, or vice versa, right? So the question then can be reformatted like whether the job I is to be assigned to machine J or not. Okay, so we have in this case the decision variable little different than we had in transportation problem. We have Xij as our decision variable. It will be taking value 1 if I is to be assigned to J. I for example stands for A, B and C, and J stands for P, Q and R. Okay, if A is to be assigned to P, then AP will be taking value 1, and if it is not to be assigned, if A is not to be assigned to P, then XAP will be taking value 0, right? So in general, Xij is 1 if I is to be assigned to J, and it is equal to 0 if I is not to be assigned to J. Okay, now if I is to be assigned to J, then the value will be 1, and only those values for which the assignment is done should get added. And because of this kind of variable, the addition will take place only for the variables which will be assigned to 1, which will be taking value 1. Okay, so your objective function is minimize z equal to 3 into x11 plus 7 into x12 plus 4 into x13 plus 8 into x21 plus 4 into x22 plus 2 into x23 plus 3 into, you just look here, plus 3 into x31 plus 1 into x32 plus 6 into x33. Now there are 9 variables. Out of these 9 variables, only 3 variables will be taking value 1. Why? Because A is to be assigned to only one of these 3, B is to be assigned to only one of these 3, and C also is to be assigned to only one of these 3, P, Q, and R. Right? And also, P is to be assigned to only one of A, B, or C. Q also is to be assigned to only one of A, B, or C, and R is also to be assigned to only one of A, B, or C. So, out of this 9 variables from x11 to x33, only 3 variables will be taking value 1 and remaining 6 will be taking value 0. We need to find out which 3 variables will be taking value 1, right? And those 3 variables will be taking value 1, adding which will be getting you the minimum cost of assignment, minimum value of Z, right? So, having written this objective function, we need to write the constraints. Now, A is to be assigned to either P or Q or R. So, we can write this statement, we can write this mathematically as x11 plus x12 plus x13. x11 means if A is to be assigned, it is a variable for assigning A with P. Variable for assigning A with Q is x12. To understand this better, I'll label this A, B, C as 1, 2, and 3. And PQR to 1, 2, and 3. So x12 is the variable standing for assignment of A and Q, and x13 is the variable standing for assignment of 1 and 4, 1 and 3. Right? So all in all, the variable, amongst the variable x11, x12 and x13, only one variable will be 1, and likewise x21, out of x21, x22, x23, only one variable will be 1, and likewise for x31, x32, x33, only one variable out of this 3 will be 1, and for this x11, x21, x31, only one variable will be 1, and hence this constant x11 plus x12 plus x13 is now here. I have not written right now the sign. Okay, in the style of if this was converted to transportation problem, then you could be writing here less than equal to. Okay. Less than equal to, and for this 3 constant you will be writing it as greater than equal to, right? But if we assume that the number of rows are equal to number of columns, then all this constraint will be equality type, right? Equality type, right? I am specifically adhering to the transportation style formulation, right? And assuming that the number of rows and number of columns may be unequal in general case, right? But if they are equal, number of rows and number of columns are equal, then you can write all these signs which are in between left hand side and right hand side at equality, right? And lastly, xij is equal to 0 or 1, right? Because that is unlike the transportation problem, wherein xij is greater than equal to 0. Here you see I have the transportation problem formulation and xij is greater than equal to 0 because xij here stand for the quantity to be transported from I to j, whereas here xij stands for whether the I is assigned to j. If it is assigned, then it will be 1, and if it is not, then the value of xij will be 0. So xij value is amongst these two, either 0 or 1. Right, so here you don't write greater than equal to 0, it is exclusively 0 or 1. Okay, now this was the formulation specific to this problem, right? And if I want to write the generalized formulation, assuming that there are m rows and n columns, okay, in a balance assignment problem, m will be equal to n. But we will be assuming m and n different. M may be equal to n or may not be equal to n. In that case, in the style of transportation, the objective function will be Cij into Xij. Okay, Cij are the cost of assignment, like you see here. These are Cij. Like for example, C23 is equal to 2, C33 is equal to 6. So Cij into Xij, Xij is the variable deciding whether there is assignment in between I and j or not. Okay. So the objective function in transportation problem is also the same, but the meaning of variable Xij here and there is different. Right. And the constraint, first constraint, is equal to first summation xij is less than equal to 1. In fact, all this constraint I should write less than equal to 1, that I'll be explaining here. Summation xij less than equal to 1, that you are seeing from here. Right from here, summation xij, where I varies from 1 to m, and j, for j is equal to, here I write that, for j is equal to 1 to n. If you set j equal to 1, okay, I'm sorry, this constraint was for j equal to 1 to n. For j equal to 1 to n, and here I is set equal to 1 to m. Alright, as soon as I set I equal to 1, I get the first constraint x11 plus x12 plus x13, j is varying from 1 to n, plus x14, so on up till x1n is less than equal to 1, and soon I set I equal to 2, I will be getting second constraint, I set I equal to 3, I will get third, and I set I equal to m, I will get mth constraint. Likewise here, the another set of constraint will come by writing the constraint for column. Okay. I is equal to 1 to m for j equal to 1 to n. Okay, for j equal to, soon I said j equal to 1, my constraint will become x11 plus x. I is varying x21 plus x31 plus x41 plus x51, so on up till xn1 is less than equal to 1. Okay, here in the transportation style it will come greater than equal to sign, but in the assignment style, if it is, you consider it totally as assignment problem, the sign will be less than equal to. Now why it will be less than equal to 1? Because it may sometimes happen in a non-square assignment problem that some of the column may not have assignment. Okay, if at all certain column has assignment, it will be 1 only, and if it doesn't have assignment, okay, the in that case this side will sum to 0. Okay, so in all the cases the sum of this side will always be less than equal to 1. Okay, maybe some column doesn't have assignment, right? Likewise, same thing may happen with the row. Some row may not have assignment if the assignment matrix is non-square matrix. Number of rows are not equal to number of columns, because we have seen there will be assignment in each of the row and in each of the column, provided the number of rows are equal to number of columns. But if it is not, then some row may not have assignment or some column may not have assignment. Okay, so in that case, this will sum to 1 or 0. This also may sum to 1 or 0. So in general, we have to write all the signs, this sum less than equal to 1 and this sum also less than equal to 1. Okay, greater than equal to sign will come if I consider this problem as the transportation problem. All right. And lastly, xij equal to 0 or 1. Okay, so based on this explanation, you try to understand this in your own way, right? I have given you the specialized formulation for this problem and from this generalized formulation also. Okay, but anyway, this formulation we have done just for the sake of doing it. We will be solving the problem by Hungarian technique, which is based on this formulation, but we will not be going into the linkage of this formulation and the Hungarian technique reduction. All right, so we'll be taking a new problem, little bigger problem, to understand the assignment model, Hungarian solution of assignment problem by Hungarian technique. Okay, so far in nutshell, what we have seen the general LPP in the constraint, the coefficient has any coefficient. In the specially structured problem, we have seen that the constraints have coefficient 1 or 0. Constraint variables in the constraint has coefficient 1 or 0. And right hand side constant may be anything. And in assignment problem, the coefficients will be 1 or 0. Coefficients of variables in constraint will be 1 or 0, as you have seen here. Coefficients of the variable are 1 or 0. They are not other than 1 or 0, right? But right hand side is essentially 1. Okay, so now we'll be seeing the assignment problem, solution of assignment problem by Hungarian technique. There are 6 machines and 5 jobs. Okay, 6 machines and 5 jobs. So this is non-square matrix, and the figures in this matrix indicate the cost of assignment. If job J1 is carried out on machine M1, it will take 10 units cost. If J1 is processed on M2, it will take 8 units cost, right? This is the cost matrix, right? And as this is the cost matrix, your objective will be minimize the total cost of assignment. Right, this will be in that case minimization problem. If the figures in this matrix indicate the profit per unit of assignment, then that will be maximization problem. We essentially will be converting maximization problem first to minimization, and then we'll be solving it. If it is already minimization problem, then we don't need to convert it, because assignment problem, transportation problem, we usually solve it by converting it to minimization problem. All right, so first of all, what you will be doing, if this is a minimization problem, you will be making this matrix as a square matrix. Why? Because if you want to have the complete assignment, every job to get a machine, every job to get assigned to machine, or every machine to get a job, one job, then essentially this matrix has to be a square matrix. Number of rows should be equal to number of columns, right? So we will now be converting this problem to a square matrix, right? We'll be converting this problem to square matrix. So you just look at how we do it. Simply, what I will be required to add a row to this matrix. Because there are six columns, so I'll be needing to add a row to make rows equal to number of columns. I cannot remove the column because that will lead to loss of information, and I don't want to do that. Okay. So I'll be adding one row. Suppose say in this matrix, there would have been four rows and six columns. What you would have done? You would have added two rows in that case. All in all, you need to make this matrix a square matrix. So number of rows or column to be required to be added will be equal to the gap between number of rows and number of columns. Okay. So here I need to add one row. Suppose say there would have been six rows and four columns. In that case, you will be adding two columns to make the number of columns equal to number of rows, right? So here I have added the row, okay? And all this data in this matrix I have copied in this matrix, and one row which I have added, I will be putting zero in that row. The cost of assignment, this is not J6, that way I'll be writing here dummy. This is dummy, and if there are more than one rows, then you will be labeling them as dummy 1, dummy 2, dummy 3, like that, right? So here, as there is only one row we are adding, we are calling it as dummy, okay? So here, all the elements in that row will be zero. In dummy row or dummy column, all the elements will be zero. But before you do that, you ensure that you are handling minimization problem. So if it is a maximization problem, you will be first converting it to minimization, and then you will be balancing the rows and columns of the matrix. And after balancing, to whatever you add, whether it be row or column, all the cells will be containing zero value, right? So now, what you need to, after having this balanced, what you need to do is to reduce the minimum quantity from each of the row. Okay, we'll be reducing minimum quantity from each of the row. So let's see how we do it in technique. You have to subtract minimum element in each of the row from all the elements in that row. So let us carry out that operation. That operation is called as row reduction, right? And from the first row, I am finding that the minimum in the first row is 6. So I'll be subtracting 6 from all the elements in that row. And here I have, so what is that? 10 minus 6 is 4. Then 8 minus 6 is 2, 13 minus 6 is 7, 20 minus 6 is 14, 16 minus 6 is 10, and 6 minus 6 is 0. And the quantity which I am reducing, which I am subtracting from each of the row, and whenever I will be subtracting, I will be just maintaining the count of it. So first I have subtracted 6 here, okay, right? This I am maintaining just to demonstrate you something at the end, Okay, as a part of routine process, you don't have to do this maintaining and the count. Okay, then in the second row, minimum value in the second row is 12. 12 I'll be subtracting from all the elements in the second row. So I get 12 minus 12, 0, 20 minus 12, 8, 25 minus 12, 13, then 17 minus 12, 5, then 18 minus 12, 6, and 14 minus 12, 2. All right? And then in the third, 12 I have subtracted from the second row. Right? Then from the third row, minimum element is 4. So from third row, I'll be subtracting 4. So here I get 12 minus 4 is 8. 11 minus 4, 7. 4 minus 4, 0. 9 minus 4, 5. 6 minus 4, 2. 10 minus 4, 6. All right. Then fourth row. Minimum in the fourth row is 5. 5 I'll be subtracting from the from all the elements in fourth row. 5 minus 5 is 0. Then 13 minus 5 is 8. 9 minus 5 is 4. 12 minus 5 is 8. 12 minus 5 is 8 again. And 11 minus 5. What that 11 minus 5 6. All right, then fifth row. In fifth row, minimum is 9. Okay, 9 I'll be subtracting from all the elements in fifth row. So 10 minus 9 is 1, 14 minus 9 5, 13 minus 9 4. Right. 9 minus 9, 0, 15 minus 9 is 6, and 12 minus 9 is 3. Alright? And minimum in this means 6th row is 0. So subtracting 0 from all will get you all 0s. Okay? So 0 you may not write here. Okay? Now this process is called as row reduction. In this is also called as this matrix is also called as ROCM. Okay, ROCM stands for row opportunity cost matrix. Okay, from this matrix to get this matrix, we have subtracted minimum from each of the row from all the elements in that row. This is called as ROCM. Or you may call this simply as row reduction. ROCM, long form is row opportunity cost matrix. Right? This in fact tells you the cost for penalty for or opportunity cost for not using the shortest cell of assignment. For example, J1 should be assigned to M6. If it is assigned to M6, then the opportunity cost will be 0. But if it is not assigned to M6 and say it is assigned to M5, the opportunity cost will be 10. And if it is assigned to M4, then additional cost or penalty will be 14, right? Right? So that is row opportunity cost matrix. The operations which we have performed on each of the row, we now will be performing on each of the column of this matrix, ROCM. And this process is called as TOCM, total opportunity cost matrix. So from minimum element in each of the row, we'll be subtracting minimum element from each of the column from all the elements in that column. Okay, so minimum element, as you are seeing here in each of the column, is 0. So what we'll be doing, we'll be subtracting 0 from the element in respective column. So 4 minus 0, 0, 4 minus 0, 4, 0 minus 0, 0, like that means all the elements in each of the column will be retained as those are. Still I'll be writing it 4, 0, 8, 0, 1, 0. You may or may not rewrite this matrix. This itself you can declare as TOCM. Okay, but for making you understand the total process, I am intentionally doing this. Here itself you could have written TOCM, but you should not do that always. That's why I am writing TOCM separately. Okay, suppose say these elements would not have been 0, they would have been something different. Then you were required to subtract minimum element in this column, that would have been 2 in that case. Right, so in that case TOCM would have been different from ROCM. Here however it is same. Suppose say there would not have been 0, again you would have transformed this column to contain 0 by subtracting 2 from each of the element in this column. Okay, so anyway my TOCM is not changing, right? But for you not to have the impression that ROCM is equal to TOCM, it's not actually, right? I am writing TOCM even though it is same as ROCM. Okay, 2, 8, 7, 8, 5, 0. Then 7, 13, 0. 4, 4, 0, 14, 5, 5, 8, 0, 0. These are again zeros. Then 10, 6, 2, 8, 6. 10, 6, 2, 8, 6. And then 0, 2, 6, 6, 3. Alright, so I got TOCM. Okay, this is similar, this is same in this case as ROCM. Now, assigning in this matrix is same as assigning in this matrix, is same as assigning, doing the assignment in this matrix. From the formulation, by doing little analysis on generalized formulation of assignment problem, you will come to know that you can subtract any constant quantity from any of the row, right? You can subtract any constant quantity from any of the column, or you can subtract a constant quantity from whole the matrix, right? Without affecting the assignment matrix through the perspective of assignment. Assignment done in this matrix will be optimal assignment done in this matrix will be same as optimal assignment done in this matrix will be same as doing the optimal assignment in this matrix. So we have, or the Hungarian mathematicians have developed the process based on the analysis of that LPP assignment, that let us subtract minimum quantity from each of the row, then subtract minimum quantity from each of the column and get this one. Now this is the matrix which has at least one zero in each of the row and in each of the column, and zero is the place where you need to do the assignment. Zero signifies that it was minimum in the column and minimum in the row, right? So this TOCM is total opportunity cost matrix. So now what you do, you start doing the assignment, and you should attempt to get as many assignments as possible, right? But you know very well that in one row you can do one assignment and in one column you can have only one assignment. So you should give the first opportunity to that zero which is only one in that row or in that column. So if there exists only one zero in a row or in a column, okay, in while you do the scanning row wise, you do the assignment to that zero which is alone in the row. Okay, so I have started from this row and I'm finding that this is only zero, so I do the assignment. That is to say, J1 is assigned to M6. Doing the assignment, just to we make the square around the zero, and as doing the assignment means it is to be done at the place where there is zero. You should not do it at any other place. That is one thing. And doing the assignment is signified by squaring the zero. Okay. Now that you have done assignment here, it means that M6 cannot be assigned to any other job. So I'll be cancelling all the zeros which exist in that column. Right? This was the zero because now M6 is assigned to J1, so M6 cannot be assigned now to J6. Okay, now come on to go to second row. Second row has only one zero here, so you can say, had there been two zeros in the second row, you would have skipped that row and you would have gone to third row. Okay, just to check whether third row has only one zero. Okay, so you would have assigned to that zero because that is only one in that row. Okay, here however second row also has only one, so you will be doing your next assignment here. Done. Okay, having done that, you find whether there exist any more zeros in the column. Okay, which if they exist, you cancel them, you cross them. So here you did that, crossed. Now you go to third row. Okay, third row also has only one zero. Okay, so you do the assignment there. Okay, after having done the assignment at zero place in third row, you cancel all the zeros in the column, in that column, because you cannot do the assignment in more than one assignment in any column or any row, right? So here now in the fourth row you don't have any zero. Okay, so you cannot do any assignment in the fourth row. Now you go to fifth row. In fifth row this is the only zero, so you will be doing the assignment here. All right, and after having done this assignment, you will be cancelling all the zeros in that column where you did the last assignment. So you will be cancelling all the zeros if they whichever exist in the column of M4, right? Then you will be going to sixth row. Now there are two. Okay, now there are two. You may assign to this zero or you may assign to this zero, or you will start scanning column wise. Okay, so you come to first column. That is already gone because the assignment is already done there, and you will be going to second column. There is only one zero, okay, in the second column, so you will be doing the assignment here, right? And you will be cancelling this zero. Now visually you are seeing that there are no more zeros left, and that's why you cannot proceed with this thing ahead. Okay, what you did, you scanned row wise and search for the minimum number of zero in the row, and there you did your first assignment. Okay, and then once after the rows are exhausted or any row has more than one zero and there is no row to scan ahead, then you will be scanning scanning the things column wise to search for minimum zeros in column. Okay, so this process you will be in position to do as the way I have done it. Now having done this, okay, what we will be doing now, we'll be counting the number of locations 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we required 6. Okay, we have got only 5 assignments. Okay, Had we got 6 assignments, our problem was over here itself. But now that we have got 5, okay, we have got 5, we need to get more zeros. We have got 5 because all the zeros we have exhausted. So this implies that we have the need for more zeros. Now you have to modify this matrix. This matrix was called as TOCM. Now from this we will be getting modified TOCM. How to get how to modify TOCM? Okay, for that you just know one thing, that you will have to cancel all the zeros. You will have to cover all the zeros under horizontal or vertical line. Okay, you just now understand the process which I am going to discuss now for getting modified TOCM. So what you do, you find the row which doesn't contain, row or rows which doesn't contain assignment, and tick mark that row, okay, or rows, right? So this row contain assignment, this contain, this doesn't contain, so you tick mark that, okay, this contains and this contains. So you will be tick marking the row or rows which doesn't contain assigned zero or assignment. Now in that row you find for the cross zero, and whichever columns in that row contain cross zero, you tick mark that column. So you have tick marked this, okay, and there is no other cross zero in that row. Now having got this tick mark in the column, you search for assigned zero in that column, okay. You don't search anywhere else. In the column having tick mark, new tick mark, you search for assigned zero, and you tick mark the corresponding row, okay, and in this row again you search for cross zero, okay. If that doesn't there doesn't exist cross zero in this row, then your process will stop here, otherwise it will continue like this only, okay. So now that you have got tick marked rows and tick marked columns, what you need to do is you have to draw horizontal line in marked column and unmarked row, okay, unmarked row, that is you will be cancelling this and this. All the intention of this process is to cover all the zeros by horizontal and vertical line. If it is possible for you to do this without this process, then also that is accepted, that process is accepted, but the point is you have to cover all the zeros with minimum number of lines. Okay, all the zeros have to be covered either by horizontal line or vertical line by minimum number of lines, okay, and this process ensures that the zeros are covered by minimum number of lines, okay. I will once again repeat this process, okay. You mark the row which doesn't contain assignment. Tick mark the row which doesn't contain assignment. Then in that row you find for cross zero, okay, and you tick mark the column containing cross zero or containing cross zeros. Then in the column which you have recently tick marked, you find for assigned zeros. Assigned zero and tick mark the corresponding row, right? And in that row which you have recently tick marked, you find for cross zero, and as soon you get cross zero, you tick mark the column and continue this process. The process will come to an end by itself, like this has come to an end, okay. And so what you do, you cancel marked row and unmarked column. Okay, to make you remember, I just write unmarked column, marked row. UCMR. UC means unmarked column and marked row. Okay, just a minute. Marked column and unmarked row. Marked column, unmarked row. Okay. So unmarked row means unmarked means untick marked row. So this is not tick marked. I am going to cancel this. Okay. I am going to cancel this by a dotted line. Okay, this is also unmarked. I am going to cancel this, cover this by dotted line. And this is marked, so I am not going to cover it. Okay, and this is unmarked, so I am going to cover it. This is marked, I am not going to cover it. This is unmarked, I am going to cover it. Unmarked rows, I have to cover. And marked column, I have to cover. Alright. Now, here you are seeing that all the columns, all the zeros are under horizontal and vertical line. Right? I'll be doing that properly by another ink. Okay, this is cancelled. This is also cancelled. I think yellow line is now visible to you. This is cancelled. This is cancelled. Unmarked rows, I have drawn horizontal line, and marked column, I have drawn vertical line. Okay. And now you are seeing that amongst uncovered, there is no zero. Okay. That was the purpose of this operation, this process we have done. Right. This process we are doing for getting more number of zeros so that we complete the assignment. Okay. Now, after having done this, there are another approaches also of covering all the zeros by minimum number of horizontal or vertical lines. Right. One thing you will notice that the number of lines required to cover all the zeros will be equal to the number of assignments done by you. Okay, so like you here you see you have done 5 assignments, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 assignments, and how many lines you are required? 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. You cannot cover all the zeros by 4 horizontal or vertical lines. It will require 5, minimum 5. Alright. Now, what you need to do is you find out minimum amongst all uncovered elements. So here you, what is that? Amongst all uncovered. See, this is minimum is 2. And here minimum amongst all uncovered, minimum seems to be 2. So what you need to do now, you subtract 2 from all uncovered. Okay. So just to help that out, right? Just to help it, I'll be doing as I speak, right? So minimum amongst all uncovered is 2. So I'll be subtracting 2 from uncovered elements only. So see what happens here, right? Just to have the full thing, all the things inside. Alright. So minimum is 2. I am subtracting from all uncovered element. This 2 is minimum from all uncovered. So 2 I will be subtracting from uncovered element. So here I get 6. 8 minus 2, 6, 13 minus 2, 11, 5 minus 2, 3, 6 minus 2, 4, and 2 minus 2, 0, and continuing that here again, 8 minus 2, 6, 4 minus 2, 2, 8 minus 2, 6, 6 again, and 6 minus 2, 4. Okay, So 2 you have subtracted, minimum was 2 and that you have subtracted from uncovered. Now whatever you have subtracted, you add it to the value at the joint of horizontal and vertical line. Okay, so here there is a joint of horizontal and vertical. So 2 you will be adding there. Whatever you have subtracted, you will be adding that at joints. 6. Here also there is a joint. So that 2 you will be adding here 2. Right? So here you will be adding that 8 plus 2, 10. Then here there is a joint. Right? And you will be adding that 2, 1 plus 2 is 3. And here also there is a joint, you'll be adding 2 to that 0. And rest there. Now, having added the elements, having added the value 2 to all the elements at the joint, you now retain all other elements as those were, right? So here there was 2, 7, 14, then 10 and 0. Alright. Then 0 here. Then 7, 0, 5, 2, 6. Alright. Then here there is a here what? Here there is 0. I've retained it. Then all these elements 5, 4, which come under just one line, no joint. You've retained those elements 5, 4, 0, 6, 3. Then 0, 0, 0, 0. 0. What we did, once again in short, you find out amongst minimum amongst all uncovered element, that was 2, you subtracted that 2 from all uncovered, then you have added this 2 to all the joints which are there in the above matrix. All the joints means intersection of horizontal and vertical line, you add that 2, and rest of the element you retain as those were. So you have got new zeros. In the process of addition of the value at the joint, you may lose some zeros, but that is for better, right? So once again you are ready for doing the assignment. Okay, so you just start from the first row. Here there is only one zero. So what you will be doing, you will be doing the assignment there. And after you do the assignment, you know now what you need to do next. You cancel all the zeros which exist in that column where you have done the assignment. Then you go to second row. Now there is only one zero to where you can do the assignment. Okay, this zero was there, but that has cancelled, so that won't come in the counting. There is only one live zero where you can do the assignment. So you have done the assignment here, and you will be doing the cancellation of the zeros which exist in that column. There was only one. Then you go to third row. There is only one zero. So what do? You do the assignment here and cancel all the zeros which exist in that column. Then you go to fourth row. You cannot do the assignment in fourth row because there is no zero. Then you go to fifth row. Okay. You go to fifth row and there is only one zero. So you did the assignment there and you cancel all the zeros which exist in that column. Then you go to sixth row. There are two zeros. Okay, when there are two zeros, as algorithm says, you then start scanning the column. Okay, had there been only one, your process of assignment was finished there itself. So if there is one zero, there are two zeros in the last row. So what do? You start from first column. There is no zero where you can do the assignment in first column. Assignment is already done in first column. In second column, assignment is not done, but there is only one zero, you do the assignment there. Okay, and cancel all the zeros in that row. Now, again, now you, what you are seeing that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 assignments done. Again, we are short of zero. Okay, so what we will be doing, again, we'll be carrying out the same process which you have understood in the last iteration. So you will be doing the, you will be tick marking the row, you'll be tick marking the row or rows which doesn't contain assignment. So here it is, you tick mark. Then you will be searching for cross zero. Here it is, cross zero is there. So you will be tick marking here. Then you will be searching for the assigned zero. Okay, and corresponding row you will be tick marking. Then in this tick mark row, you will be searching for cross zero or zeros. Wherever there are cross zeros, you will be tick marking the corresponding column. Okay, here you tick mark. Had there been cross zero here, here also you would have tick marked. Okay. Now, for this new tick mark, you will be searching for assigned zero. Whenever you have to search in a column, you search for assigned zero. And whenever you have to search in a row, you search for cross zero. Okay. So, where you are? So, here there is the assignment, you tick mark this corresponding row. And then you search for the cross zero. You search for cross zero. If that exists, tick mark the column. If the that doesn't, cross zero is not there, then the process will automatically stop because you cannot proceed ahead. Okay. So now what you will be doing? Mark column and unmarked row. Mark column you will be canceling. Okay, now with confidence you can do mark column. You have cancelled. This is marked. And this is also marked. You have cancelled. And unmarked row you cancel. Here it is. Okay, unmarked row you cancel. Right? Unmarked row, marked column. The purpose is to cover all the zeros with horizontal and vertical line. Okay, whether the process is right or not can be brought to your notice if some of the zero is not covered. Okay, this process will ensure that all the zeros are covered. Okay, right here you see, is there any zero which is not covered? All the zeros are covered either under horizontal or vertical line or both. Okay, now that we have done this, we will once again be finding the minimum amongst all uncovered element. Okay, right, minimum amongst all uncovered element. So you, what you do, you find minimum happens to be 2. Okay, amongst all uncovered, minimum happens to be 2. Okay, in all the rows, but you search for uncovered element. So minimum happens to be 2 you subtract from all the elements. All right, so here we go. Uncovered element processing. So 2 minus 2 0, then 7 minus 2 5, 14 minus 2 12, 10 minus 2 8. Right, 6 minus 2 4, 11 minus 2 9, 3 minus 2 1, 4 minus 2 2, and come on to this uncovered element. 6 minus 2 4, 2 minus 2 0, 6 minus 2 4, and 4. Now, what you have subtracted, 2 you have subtracted, add that 2 at the joint. So, here there is a joint, 10 plus 2 12. Alright, then here also there is a joint, 3 plus 2, 5. Here also there is a joint, 2 plus 2, 4. And you search the joint wherever it exists, you have to add that element. 6 plus 2, 8. Alright. Then here 3 plus 2, 5. Alright. Then 0 plus 2, 2. We have added the element which we have subtracted, add the joints, and rest of the elements you have to retain. So 6 will be here, 0, and on this side 0 and 0. Alright, then here I can write this element 7052. Alright, then this is already processed, but this element is yet to be written, 0 and 4. Then this 5406. Alright, then 0000. Okay, so once again I repeat the process. Find the minimum element from all uncovered elements and subtract it from uncovered element. Add that element to the joints of horizontal and vertical line. Rest of the elements retain as those were in the previous matrix. Okay, this is modified TOCM. Modification, this is again you may label it as MTOCM. This itself was also, this itself was MTOCM, this was modified. But now, one thing we forgot to do while getting this matrix, okay, if you recall, we have subtracted 2, okay, we have subtracted 2 while getting this matrix, so that 2 we forgot to write here. And from this matrix to get this matrix, we have subtracted 2 again, right? So this 2, minus 2 we have subtracted for getting this matrix from this matrix, and 2 I have subtracted for getting this matrix from this matrix, okay? Now, once again, after getting this matrix, we will be doing the assignment. So in this row, now you have 2 zeros, so skip that. In this row again you have 2, in this row you have 1, so you do the first assignment here, and after doing that, okay, cancel the zeros in that column, okay. Now you can do the assignment here because this is the only one zero, and after doing the assignment here, you cancel all the zeros which exist in that column. So here it is cancelled. Now because of this cancellation, there is only one zero remaining here. Okay. So you can do the assignment there now. And because you did the assignment here, you can cancel this. Okay. And if there is any more zero in that column, right, and because this zero has cancelled, this is now alone, only one in the first row, so this is also assigned, okay. And now we have done the assignment here, this is cancelled, okay. Once you do the assignment, you have to do, you have to cancel all the zeros which exist in that column, okay. Now that, now we need to come to fourth row. Fifth row, okay, till fourth row assignments are over. Fifth row, this is 1 0, okay, here there is 1 0, so we will be doing the assignment there, and once the assignment is done here, you will be cancelling this cross 0, alright, and now that you have cancelled this cross 0, in sixth row, there is only 1 0 remaining, and that is done, that is squared for assignment. Now you count the number of assignments done, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay. If the number of assignment done is equal to number of rows or column which are equal in themselves, your assignment is done. One job is assigned to one machine, okay. So what is your assignment? J1 is assigned to M2. You can write this answer. J1 is assigned to M2. J2 is assigned to M6. J3 is assigned to M3. Wherever you find the square 0, J4 is assigned to M4. Alright, J5 is assigned to J5 is assigned to J4 is assigned to M1. J4 is assigned to M1 and J5 is assigned to M4. And J6, actually it is not J6, it is dummy. So far we had been carrying it as J6, but it is dummy. So dummy is assigned what? J5. Dummy is assigned to M5. Okay, and what is the cost of assignment? That also we can now, in this matrix, this appears to be 0 everywhere, but you will be referring to the cost of assignment from original matrix. Okay, where is that? This is the original matrix, the first iteration matrix. So J1, M2, the cost is 8. Okay, J2, M6, the cost is 14. J3, M3, the cost is 4. J4, M1, cost is 5. J4, M1, cost is 5. J5, M4, cost is 9. And dummy M5, the cost is 0, and the total cost of assignment comes out to be equal to 8 + 14 = 22 + 4 = 26 + 5 = 31 + 9, that is 40. Total cost of assignment is 40. Okay, so this algorithm that way is very simple, but still there are chances that you may make mistakes. So you need to find, you need to have a check with yourself. And here we have that kind of check. Whatever the quantities we have reduced so far should be equal to the total cost of assignment 40, which you have got. Okay, total cost of assignment which you have got is 40. Okay, and what are the reductions we have done so far? Just count them all. 2 plus 2, 4 plus 9, 13 plus 5, 18 plus 4. I think it seems there is something missing, but we will fill up the gap. Okay, 4 plus 9 plus 9, 22 plus 22. 9 plus 9, 18 plus 4, 22, 22 plus 2, 24 plus 6, 30, and 3 plus 1, 4, 40. 40 is the total reduction done, and the reduction done is equal to, this is equal to this, total cost of assignment is equal to total reduction. That confirms your answer. That is a check for you being right. Okay, so this is what is assignment problem. All right, one more thing I need to discuss, this with this kind of with this method you will be, it will be possible for you to solve any assignment problem, but one thing I must mention here, that if the problem would be the maximization problem, if this problem was a maximization problem, if the problem given to you initially is a maximization problem, then what you will be doing? You will be finding maximum element in this matrix and subtracting it from all the elements in that, in this matrix. Okay, from that maximum element You will be subtracting all the elements exactly the same way we did in transportation problem, which was of maximization type. So what you will be doing here, maximum value you are finding is 25. So far, is there any more thing? 25 is maximum. So what you will be doing, you will be subtracting all the values from 25, and you will be getting a new matrix. It will be 5x4 matrix, and that will be equivalent minimization problem. And in that equivalent minimization problem, you will now be adding a row for balancing the number of columns and the number of rows. Okay. And now that you have got 6x6 equivalent minimization problem, you will be solving it ahead, getting the assignment, optimal assignment. And once you get the assignment, you will be posting those assignment in the original problem, and you will be getting the value of Z or the profit. Okay, value of Z you will be getting, right? So that's how to handle the maximization problem. Okay, here, once again, coming back to the solution, okay. Our machine M5 is going to be idle, okay, because it is not getting any job, and it is for getting optimal solution, you can afford M5 to keep idle, okay. Like there was some issue in transportation problem, we have discussed that if there is no value in some of the cell, then what to do? What we do in transportation problem is equally valid in assignment problem as well. Suppose say this cell doesn't have value. Okay, this cell doesn't have value. Okay, so in if this is a minimization problem, you can straightway replace that dash by infinity sign. Okay. But if this is a maximization problem, first you will be converting it to minimization by retaining the dash as it is, and in once it converts to minimization problem, you will be replacing dash by infinity sign. Okay, so all in all, if the problem is maximization, first convert it to minimization and then do further processing. If there is dash somewhere, you convert it to infinity, or if there is a gap between number of rows and number of columns, you fill in that gap by that many number of rows or that many number of columns. This is unlike the transportation problem, wherein only one row or one column is to be added the total of requirement is equal to total of capacity. Here, however, we have to add multiple number of rows. Okay, in this problem, we have added just one. Okay, so I hope you have understood this problem, and now we'll be stopping here. Right, thank you very much.